thank you very much for asking me to speak to you. I'm slightly overwhelmed by your campus, since in New York it's blizzard conditions. Slight culture shock. I thought what I'd do is talk to you for about 50 minutes, and then let's have a discussion. And I'd like to do this particularly because this is new work that I've done in this book called Together, which is a book on cooperation. And I particularly want to share with you some ideas I've had about the sort of spatial dimensions of cooperation. And I'm not quite sure what I think, so maybe you'll help me sort that out. Have some of you read some chapters of the book? Is that right? Oh, good. Okay. I thought what I'd like to do is talk about spaces of cooperation. And I thought what I'd do in the presentation is talk to you a little about what cooperation means, what a space of cooperation looks like, and give you some tools about understanding the skill in living in a space of cooperation, and then consider some problems that this entails for thinking about planning. That's a lot to cover, but I'll try and do this succinctly. I guess the background to all of this is that it's no news to any of you as Americans that our society is, in its political life, suffering a kind of crisis of cooperation. It's all the Republicans' fault to make it more complicated than that. It's also true that in the workplace that we are suffering a kind of crisis of cooperation, which will be clearer to you in the course of this talk. And I would say what is maybe not so clear is that there is also a profound issue about where we cooperate physically with other people, which involves the city. So that's the background to what I want to say here. Let me start by saying what cooperation means. There's a very simple definition that you can use of it, and that is that cooperation means working with others to do things you can't do for yourself. And that's something which is natural to us as an animal species. When babies are born, they can't survive without working with a parent for food and for orientation. It's something they can't do for themselves, obviously, for as newborns. But there is a kind of developmental narrative to that simple definition. And it is that as human beings evolve and mature, that they become faced with tasks which are more challenging and require more skill, that are not innate, or difficult tasks of cooperation. And there are, just to signal this to you in this developmental narrative, there are kind of two, I think, key stages in which cooperation moves from being something that we know how to do, that's natural to us, that's embedded in us, to something that we have to learn and become skilled at. The first of those occurs around the age of 5, when the issue of cooperation begins to surface in relation to questions of autonomy of young children. Up to that time, cooperation is kind of win-win exchange. And I try and show in my book how that operates. That is, by cooperating with you, we both gain something, the parent and the child. But around the age of five, the question of autonomy begins to emerge as a kind of zero-sum game possibility. That is, if I work with you, that I lose something in myself. And children suffer a kind of crisis in what were natural habits of cooperating with each other by the notion that some part of something that they know is themselves is being given away. The other kind of drama in this narrative of natural cooperation appears in the relationship of cooperation and competition. It's often said particularly by narrow-minded, capitalistically minded people, that cooperation and competition are opposed to each other. And this is a kind of view which would only come to somebody who has never played a team sport. It's not merely the question of cooperating with others like yourself in order to compete against somebody else, but as in sports, you have to agree on the rules with another group, with your competitors in order to play. It's not simply a kind of warfare in which anything goes. And that becomes increasingly true in the development of human cooperation through the life cycle. That people have to learn how to coordinate cooperation and competition rather than treating them simply as brutal opposites. The final preliminary remark I want to make about this is to explain what the term pleasures of cooperation means in my book. I don't mean by this a kind of usual feel-good factor. I mean what psychoanalysts call ego strength, the pleasure of feeling that you can be master of situations in which you're engaged with other people, in which you have needs with other people, without feeling that you're incompetent. And that the pleasure is the feeling that you are able to manage difficult situations which are multi-level, which contain dissonances of autonomy, contain challenges of how to combine cooperation and competition. That as people become skilled in this, that they experience a kind of deep pleasure, or another way to put this is a kind of self-confidence, that they are not condemned simply to being blindly aggressive or blindly submissive to other people. And that's an ego strength which I think is the sort of reward from adult cooperation, but it's also something that modern society tends to inhibit, frustrate. So that's where I start in thinking about what cooperation is. And it sets the framework for thinking about what are those skills that allow people, in fact, to practice difficult sorts of cooperation. I want to say to you something also in a kind of definitional way about what I mean by a space of cooperation. And there are two models for this. One of them are the Out of Wall Street movements, which are a form of self-organized cooperation that focuses on cooperating in the center. And the other is something I'm going to describe to you rather arcane experience of managing traffic, which locates the space of cooperation at the edge between different communities. The Out of Wall Street, I have to say, I'm an unregenerate socialist. I keep hoping that Barack Obama will say to those right-wingers, yes, I am socialist. Doesn't seem to get it together. But for me, I was also quite despairing about whether the kind of socialism I believe in, which is from the ground up, which is community-based, would ever have much reality in the current economic crisis. So for me, this out of Wall Street movements have been, in my old age, they've made me feel pretty good about the left. But I'm also interested in them as spatial formations. I've spoken to quite a number of them in New York and London. And as spatial formations, what has impressed me is that they're not just a mass of people randomly distributed, that they're self-organized spaces in which people take on very differentiated roles in order to make the spaces work. In both London and New York, for instance, which occupied territories that were never meant for anything like a political encampment, they've been divided up into places where people sleep, places for portaloos, and where to get food, mostly revolting pizza in New York, but nonetheless, the space where it comes. Speaking spaces, obviously, and communication centers. They tend to be self-organizing in which different kinds of people take over different kinds of spaces. When you've seen on the television, the pictures of these Occupy movements, they tend to focus on what journalists think a protester looks like. That's usually somebody like you, a young college student. If they're wearing a bandana, even better, or even clothing, you know. In fact, in both London and New York, there are large numbers of middle-aged unemployed people and there are large numbers of the elderly, and they never appear on the TV cameras. Nobody ever points the camera to them. And one of the things that has interested me about the spatial organization of this is how the role that those people play in doing things that in London, a group of rather elderly people became responsible for getting tents clean, middle-aged, out-of-work women who dealt with the media center, not roles you would think would immediately fit together. But the point about this is that it is a space of cooperation which has a defined center and focus. And that's one way that politically spaces of cooperation are built. Spaces of cooperation on the edge have a different kind of, or there are more edge conditions, a different kind of configuration. And I'm going to describe to you what may seem to you a bizarre instance of this, but one that I find really interesting. In Taunton, which is a town in the southwest of England, there is a famous traffic intersection which backs up, was full of traffic signs, stop and go signs, directional signs, and so on, that famously backed up traffic for miles and miles and miles in all directions. And a couple of years ago, as an experiment, the town fathers removed all the traffic signs from this huge six ways, different ways traffic comes in, so that there were no directional instructions given, save a warning sign saying you were about to enter a complex traffic zone without any signs. Pay attention. And it required people to to break out of the habits that they had about how to behave in traffic, to exercise lots of peripheral vision and lots of peripheral judgment. And this traffic signless, it's not one junction, it's a huge spaghetti of junction, has, by privileging people's capacity to cooperate physically with each other, there's very little, you can't shout out of your window, I go next, but to use their visual judgment in order to see what's happening, when they should yield, to whom they should yield and not, has proved an absolute success. It's been, except for blind people, it's a story in itself. It's being replicated in the Netherlands, it'll probably be tried even in Germany, which will be kind of, people drive it very fast, kind of incredible test. But I just cite this to you as a kind of way of people practicing cooperation, which doesn't have to do with coordination in a center, but rather with a kind of perception and behavior that deals with edge conditions, literally, usually at the edge, also their edge condition. And it's made drivers more skilled because they're more attentive to the surroundings in which they're in because there are no noises. So I would say these are two kind of models to think in mind as I describe to you spaces of cooperation. One which is coordination in the center, and the other which is dealing with, in technical terms, liminality. That is, edge conditions of, in this case, movement and judgment. I now want to say something to you about what are the skills that are required to practice cooperation of this more difficult sort, which is not instinctive to us, but which is learned. What is, if you like, the craft of coordination? And I hope you'll forgive me if I talk rather abstractly about this. I want to talk about three issues with you that divide along three lines. One is the line between dialectical and dialogical cooperation. The second divides along the line of formalized and informal cooperation. And the third divides along the lines of sympathy and empathy in the experience of the other. The most important of these is the difference between dialogical and dialectical practices of cooperation. To put this in its, maybe in a very crude form, that when we think about the dialectics of cooperation, we're thinking about the give and take of argument. When we think about the dialogics of cooperation, we're thinking about listening skills. So the first is something that is a verbalized response to others by presenting something of oneself to them, which is often contrary. And the second is, in dialogics, is something about trying to fathom what the other is thinking or feeling, to bring them out. I should say about this, I know you all got in school probably a version of dialectics which is supposed to be based on Hegel and is an insult to Hegel. That is, it's a thesis. I say X, there's an antithesis, you say not X, and then there's a synthesis, and that is X and Y combined together in a new Z. This isn't at all what Hegel meant by dialectics, or for that matter, going all the way back to Plato, what Plato meant by dialectics. The Hegelian idea is really embodied in something called a master-slave relationship, which is really at the heart of the phenomenology of knowledge. And it's this, that the master presents a thesis to his slaves, like, you're not working hard enough, you're lazy. And the slaves, rather than responding, what do you mean? We're working very hard, and besides, you're abusing us. Step out of the language frame that the master has set up and say, you know something? This is a very interesting piece of rock that we're knocking on. They displace the master's language. The master goes, what? I'm talking about you not working hard enough, and you're talking to me about this interesting rock. That displacement, if they keep in contact with each other for Hegel, means that ultimately they begin learning to find a common language which encompasses these irreconcilable contraries. They don't get mushed into one agreement, but that they learn how to understand what each other are saying. And this is that which is a synthesis. This is it's a version also of dialectics, which if you are a reader of Jürgen Habermas, you will know. That is, when you get communicative interaction, you don't abolish difference, but eventually you create a kind of common terrain where people who have different interests are able to communicate to each other in a way where they're self-expressive. A great example of this given by my friend James Scott, who's a political theorist at Yale, is what he calls hidden transcripts, where he studied slave societies to get at this, where the masters will do their number about you're not working harder or you deserve to be enslaved. The slaves will speak to each, they'll agree with him, yes, master, we're doing a terrible job, but they do it in such a way where they're communicating to each other in a kind of what Jim calls a hidden transcript. So they're actually citing to each other, even in the process of responding on his own terms in this other language. And then for Scott, what happens is that the condition of mastery breaks down as the master begins forced to be understanding what that hidden transcript, that other language, is about. And that's he studied this in Brazil. It's a familiar pattern in antebellum American speech patterns as well. So that the point about dialectics then is that it's a back and forth of expression. It's quite complicated. Dialogics is not about the response of one person to another, which makes a contrary or displacing response. The term dialogics was coined by the Russian philosopher and novelist. All good philosophers should be novelists. We don't want to go down that rabbit hole. Mikhail Bakhtin. And his notion is that listening skills are something about, in particular, dialogical listening skills, are about trying to probe what you don't understand in what somebody else says, or trying to bring them out without introducing yourself to them. So you notice this is a kind of model of psychoanalysis, it's a dialogical model. It's the notion that in attending to you, I also often would want, for instance, to figure out what you really mean, but you're not saying overtly. I want to bring that out by interaction with you. But I'm focused on you, not on me. This second thing about dialogics that makes it different from dialectics is that in dialectics you have a consummation, as in the Habermasian model. Finally, we understand a way, we find a way to talk. In dialogics, there's no consummation. It's a narrative process. You the end of a four-hour conversation say, in sum, we agree that, we disagree that, and so on. You've had a process of gradually exhuming from each other hidden meanings without coming to an agreement. In my view, this dialogics has a great deal to do with spatial experience as well as language experience. And if I only go faster in this talk, I'll explain to you what I mean by that. But there are two different kinds of skills. And the kinds of skills I'm interested in are more dialogical than dialectical, because they relate more to the kind of work people do when they're in an edge condition with people unlike themselves. And a rabbit hole I'm not going to jump down unless you invite me to do that, because I would say that with somebody like President Obama, that he has good dialectical skills and terrible dialogical skills. And that's what's gotten him into trouble. And I'm very tempted to explain that to you. So ask me, please. So there are two different kinds of skills. Learning how to listen and learning how to respond is one way to do it. Learning how to bring something to a conclusion versus learning how to dwell in a process without resolution. Both of them deal with ambiguity, but the first tends to try and address the issue of ambiguity and make it less so, make it more resolved. The second is more at home with ambiguity. And this relates to the issue between informal and formal forms of cooperation. Now, the way I've done this in my book, which you can read in some detail, it's a very cheap book. you should get all the details. It has to do, first of all, with speech acts. That formalized speech tends to be declarative, and informalized speech tends to be to be what I call subjunctive address to other people. The difference is between me saying, I think, which is a kind of formalization of a speech act, and saying, I would have thought, which is a kind of informalized subjunctive. It's a subjunctive, literally the subjunctive mood. The formalized version of this is a declaration. It offers itself as an object to other people. I believe X, X is true, however you put that. The informalized version, the subjunctive mood, leaves a lot of space for people to deal with ambiguous relations with each other. When you say, for instance, a classic English way of address, it's a very interesting talk that you've given. It's so illuminating. I would have thought, however, that X, Y, Z, you may be making a criticism. Well, what you're doing is leaving a sort of space for discussion rather than counter-argument. And learning how to do that so that you leave space for the other rather than saying, this is the way it is, declare it, addresses what the philosopher Bernard Williams calls a fetish of assertion that often kills cooperation. His notion is that assertiveness, declaration, which he sees as a form of competition, is a way of foreclosing interaction with other people. Whereas this subjunctive mood is a way of leaving a space open between people where they can then navigate. And you can see how these are related to the difference between dialectic and dialogics. I would say that these are two different kinds of speech skills, learning how to use, how and when to use the subjunctive and how and when to use the declarative mode. But but that they also relate to issues of space. That is, how do we create spaces which, like that intersection in Taunton, leave a kind of space for interpretation and ambiguity unaddressed. And I would say that that condition is something that lies in its subjunctive space rather than declarative space. A final aspect of the craft of cooperation, or the skills that it requires, has to do with the distinction between sympathy and empathy. I mean, this is an ethical distinction, but I think it's also a practical and a spatial distinction. This distinction turns on something as follows. You know it from the Bible. Do unto others as they would do, have them do unto you. Sorry, I should know. So besides, I'm brought up by nuns, but evidently it's the notion is that sympathy. That is, you identify with somebody else, and so you are willing to cooperate with them because you see that they have need of you. It's what Adam Smith in Theory of Moral Sentiment identified as the antidote to markets. That is, markets purely competitive phenomenon. But identification, this kind of sympathy, I can see that my gain is your loss and that you're suffering for that, becomes a kind of inhibition on pure market, pure market competition. But it requires something that means that, to go back to what I was talking about in the beginning, a kind of transcendence of your own autonomy. That you are able to step into another's shoes and see things the way they are. Empathy is a different kind of condition. Empathy is a condition where you see that something matters to somebody else, even though it doesn't matter to you, and you can't understand why it matters to them. When we're empathic with someone, and they're talking to us about something that is obviously disturbing to them, what we want to figure out is what's bugging them without referring to ourselves. We want to know what it's like for them in themselves to have a problem. It supposes that people do not need to be able to imagine what it would be like to experience something in order to care about it. It's, if you like, a more selfless condition. That's one way to think about it. But if you take the moral taint out of it, it has to do with things like curiosity. You know, if I don't understand you very well and you tell me about something you're excited about or something that you've suffered, what will make me empathic is to know more about it, because I'm curious. You've aroused something in me that is not familiar to me, and I want to know about it. In theories of science, the idea is that high-level science experiments are always deploy elements of empathy. That is, rather than doing an experiment and saying, well, I know what that's about. You know, I can identify with that mentally. Then you go, well, that's strange. What's that all about? That's what scientific empathy would be. And again, I'd like to argue to you that that has a spatial as well as a linguistic component. That when we're in spaces that are unfamiliar to us, when our perceptual apparatus is something that inclines us to go wander, to travel, to explore, then we're in empathic mode. when we feel like, oh my God, there's a Starbucks at last. We're in sympathy. I think that's they're both skills. It takes skill to sympathize with people who are far distant from you. It takes a capacity to relate what they are to who you are. That is a skill. But it takes a different kind of skill to exercise empathy, which is something about what either what's going on here, or that's interesting. How can I learn more about it? It's, if you like, the difference between remember this book? Famous statement of Bill Clinton, I feel your pain. Remember that? That's sympathy. Whereas empathy would be, I don't get it. It's a positive statement. I don't feel your pain. And then staying connected to the other person to get to try and find out more. So I've described to you three, I would say, skills that build ego strength of the sort that I've been talking about. The first is three skills of cooperation that build ego strength. The first has to do with the differences between dialectics and dialogics. The second has to do with the difference between formalized and informalized speech. And the third has to do with the differences between empathy, sympathy and empathy. Now, the argument I want to make to you is that for us as people concerned with the practical world of space, that we need to develop more spaces that accustom people to becoming skilled at dialogics rather than dialectics. We need to build spaces that make people more comfortable with the subjunctive, that is, with informalized transactions with each other rather than formalized transactions. And finally, we need to build spaces that encourage the development of empathy rather than sympathy. That's the argument I'd make to you about what this has to do with city planning. And I'm now going to try and make this a little more concrete to you by describing a disaster in my own practical work as a planner. In the 1980s, I was, the New York City Planning Commission asked me and a group of other people to help Spanish Harlem community, very poor community in East Harlem, develop a community market. The city was going to put money into it. They asked us to work with the community in order to bring this market into being, sell Spanish goods, wonderful peppers, be open, all of that stuff. Chorizo would be open 24 hours a day. The staff would be bilingual, et cetera, et cetera. And we made a disastrous choice. We decided, you have to pitch in on Manhattan. Spanish Harlem in the 80s lay above 96th Street, which is a dividing street in Manhattan. Above it, one of the poorest communities in the United States, which is Spanish Harlem. And below it, one of the richest communities in the world, which is the Upper East Side of New York. So the question was where to put the market. And the disaster we made was to put this market in the center of Spanish Harlem, 114th Street. If you Google it, you can see we did. We put it under railway arches. We were very pleased with ourselves. We reclaimed space. It cost a fortune, but that's the way we trained for this. What we did, in other words, is drew the community of Spanish Harlem in on itself towards the center. What we should have done is located the market on 96th Street, just at the dividing line between Spanish Harlem and Upper East Side. We should have done that because rather than enclosing the community on itself, we would have provided a material resource that would have drawn people who were different into the same place. Now, this isn't about speech. It's about physical propinquity. That is, a lady in a fur coat from Park Avenue who's run out of milk at 11 o'clock at night would have stood in the same line with to buy her milk with a Hispanic woman who may well be a cleaning lady for her or someone else. We would have done physically something that would create some of the conditions, not fully, but somewhat approach the conditions of making people aware of those unlike themselves in a cooperative act which was quite simple. They were both doing a functional thing together. And we would have, rather than close people in on their identities, we would have made a blur at the edge. And for me, in my own planning prep, La Maqueta, I mean, it succeeds, but it's because the community is poor. It only succeeds with large amounts of help from the city. But it was, I now realize, a kind of privileging the center as a space for cooperation was a form of segregation. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Kind of segregation. So I learned my lesson, as did other members of the planning, New York City Planning Commission. And New York has since tried to locate public resources on the edge between communities rather than in the centers. And in my own planning work, I've tried to take this into other situations as well. That when we are thinking about where a public resource goes, it should always be put in such a way that there's a displacement of people towards this edge condition. When you build a school, you don't build a school in the center of the community. When you build new housing or renovate housing, you renovate at the edge. Something we've been working on. We worked a lot in South Africa, in Johannesburg, my shop in London, about dealing with apartheid situation there by building things that both blacks and whites need, and particularly that Afrikaners and blacks need, in between rather than in the midst. And for me, it's a way of, it's not encouraging verbal cooperation, but it's a way of encouraging a kind of physical interaction which has some cooperative qualities. That is, it takes people out of themselves. It means that they're less declarative in the sense of where they are, and that curiosity might even just be rather than identification. So that's why I wanted to talk to you about this. I mean, this is a planning principle that I've come to believe means we've got to change. If we want to have, most of our cities are very, very complicated organisms, and some which are highly segregated in their parts. Very little mixture. Most people know homogeneity. They are likely to cooperate only with their own kind. And I would say that this is a disaster for the city as a whole. They need to learn the skills. We all need to learn the skills of feeling that we can be in the midst of difference and not respond to it, as most of us do when we're in a mixed situation, with indifference. That you're amongst people unlike yourself, and your protection is just to to behave as though they're not there. They're indifferent. To make difference, rousing, is a kind of non-verbal cooperative experience. That is, you're interested in, you're engaged in what's around you. And to do that, we need to lose the logic of center as a significant space, public space, and re-engage the notion of the edge as a significant public space. So I've given you a rather abstract, but still not very full explanation of some of the elements of cooperation, particularly the psychological aspects, which is what I wanted to emphasize in this talk. Because I think if you take these on board, it changes the logic about how we think about significant place in the city. So let me stop there. I've talked much more than I meant to. And I'd love responses, dialogical or dialectical. Do ask me about President Obama, or tell me where I'm wrong. How much time do we have? 15, 20 minutes?
We have
half an hour. Half an hour, great.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Yes, this boy back here. Was it you? No, it was you. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah. And you shout.
Yes. In your discussion of sympathy and empathy, I understand the distinctions you make, but it leaves out the issue of whether the person experiencing what it means if someone who with empathy knows or doesn't know. You emphasize curiosity. What about actual knowledge or awareness, already existing awareness of the other, or is the curiosity the only issue, as it were?
That's a really interesting issue, because there are many. I'm going to give you two responses to this. This is a really important question that you raised. One side of this, on the psychological side, is a question of when do people become content to say, I'm really never going to know what that person is like. That's when they're willing that there's something mysterious. I mean, we all do that in love affairs, but I mean, it's another metaphor. But when in dealing, in ordinary social life, at least, say, there's a limit beyond which I can't understand this person and accept them. So that's the issue about, it's a kind of, if you like, issue about modesty. That is, I can't really understand your experience. I didn't live your life. But I credit the fact that what's important to you is important. That's one issue. There's another side of this, and I talk about this in the talk, but I'll say something to you about. And that has to do with the notion of social action versus sort of psychological perception in empathy. And I'm just going to tell you a little about this because it's a really interesting thing. My teacher was Hannah Arendt. And Hannah Arendt had as much hatred for sympathy, particularly in its charitable do-gooder forms, as I think any human being could have. And I talked with her lots about this. I mean, she absolutely thought that sympathy was a form of condescension. I feel your pain. If she'd lived long enough, she would have said, that's the speech of the powerful. There's nothing you've experienced that I can't identify with. So what's the alternative to that? Well, her view of empathy is that empathy is a principle of, in the public realm, of fraternity amongst strangers. And the notion is that people practice empathy when they say, I don't know who you are, but we share something in common which transcends each of us, which is, say, a political commitment. When we act empathically, We practice fraternity in going after a common goal, which is bigger than either one of us, or which we can't really explain in personal terms to each other. And she said that's empathy as an active principle. The active principle in empathy is fraternal political action. The debate I had with her about this, and I'm still having it in my head, although she's been dead nearly 30 years, is that for me, I much more emphasized the perceptual quality of empathy rather than action. And I did that because the way Arendtian notion of fraternity is organized, it's about self-transcendence. What I presented to you is a kind of experience of empathy which is immanent rather than transcendent. That is, when I'm face to face with you, how do I attend to you in a way where I'm more curious about you right here, right now? If we have to have a superordinate principle that binds us together, which gets us outside of ourselves, we're no longer face to face. Both these views have defects. Hers is one in which people are escaping the imminent, right? In which it's not about either of them, so it's something they can cooperate on and share. But it is action. And the problem with my view is that it doesn't necessarily suggest a common course of action, which is what we usually think about when we think about cooperation. But the positive in it is what it's suggesting is that you don't escape to some other realm, that you stay face to face. Now, the only thing I can say, I mean, as I said, I'm having this debate in my head with her about this is about everything for me, since I was her student, is that I think that in spatial terms, we can create something like an experience of action as in that traffic crossing, which is kind of imminent awareness that leads to certain kinds of behavioral action. It is very difficult to formulate as a principle of its very nature. It's something which is always interrogative and exploratory. It's much more difficult to formulate it in classic terms of political cooperation. So that's where I think this... There are really two aspects to this. And it's an unresolvable issue. Make sense?
I think so.
Okay.
I'm thinking about people who are curious to be honest.
That's not so bad. I mean, if you're curious, you have to have some faith that people who have curiosity will eventually get clued in. If they're incurious and clueless, where would the list stop? Yes.
A three-part question. First of all, I applaud your recommendation that we put public infrastructure investments along the borders. I think in a fragmented society, that's very important. But three things. One is that my sense of many of these sort of infrastructures are spatial sites along the boundaries. There's a mix of outcomes. Some succeed, some don't. And from your experience, are there examples of what's successful, what's not? The second part is, what do you deduce as some of the causal factors that might lead to different outcomes? And third is, are there things as planners we could think about to implement to promote the type of skill practices you're talking about, the three skill practices? And I differ a little bit from you in terms of your interpretation of Occupy Wall Street. I see some, my experience with it is I see some real limitations and the lack of the application of those three skills. But that's just my own sort of view of it.
Let me answer your respond to your first and your third point. I can only tell you from my own planning practice that it seems to me that this kind of edge location of public resources works best when what you're locating there are relatively functional activities rather than activities like a community center. Better to put a health clinic between two communities than to put a religious center or any kind of social center, which seems kind of ironic. I'll give you an example of this. When we were, did I ever take you to the Elephant Castle project we were doing? My colleague Michael Strober, I think he's my colleague. He occasionally appears in the
place. We never went there together.
I'll give you an example of this. We worked on putting a health clinic in a place called Elephant Castle, which is a boundary line between the Islamic and the so-called native British working class in South London. And it's ill-served by... There isn't much in this way of practical care there. Both communities tended to use it pretty well because it was something that wasn't about self-consciously about engaging with the other. You know? It was a neutral, if you like, a functional service. And if that seems like it's fairly anodyne, you have to think about what it means for instance, in a waiting room for an Islamic woman in a hijab who thinks she may be about to deliver, being in the same waiting room with a British beer-swilling guy who's, you know, cut his arm. It's physical propinquity, and they learn. What we found in that center is that people learn kind of habits, if you like, of courtesy, where they become more comfortable with each other than they are outside of. What has been a disaster for us and for other people who have tried to design schools is to put schools in this same kind of situation. It is a functional service, but it's much more than that. And I have a colleague who tried to do this in Birmingham, to locate three schools in the edges of three different ethnic communities. It didn't work. It was too surcharged. So what I've come to feel about this is that, as a practical matter, what you want to do is identify, if you like, low-intensity usages, functional usages that people can share, and hope that that's going to be a place where people in this relatively uncharged environment will become more tolerant of each other. The skills building issue about this for planning is, I mean, one way to think about this is to this would take us days to talk this through, is a question about how do we cooperate with clients. Now, you know, it's a mantra of almost all modern planning, you know, that we're going to do cooperative planning with our clients. And probably any of you who have been involved in this know what I've experienced is when you say to people, I'm only here to serve you. You know, you tell me what you want and I'll help you build it. That what you get is the most conservative response possible. That is, people want to put up something that's familiar. In the housing sector in Britain, what we get is gingerbread housing, Victorian gigas, because this is what people know. And the planner was going, well, only here to serve you, is thinking inside, God, this is crap. Why are we putting up this junk from a century ago, while at the same time saying, let me help, you know, etc. But it's a more structural issue in planning, which is what are the conditions under which we work cooperatively with clients. I can only tell you how I've resolved this in my own planning practice, which is that when I work and my team work with communities, what we do is we try to, we will build two or three alternative versions of a project that people say they want to build a park or something like that. We will come in and there are physical models, nothing on screen, but physical models, people can walk around and so on, and say, look, these are, for us, three possible ways to get what you want. And they're very different, and let's talk them through and you decide. So you're using your expertise. You're not there as, you know, I'm here as research, you know. You're saying, I know how to do this. But what we should do is something that we've got to work through. And I'm going to start the discussion by giving you the models of what you might possibly be able to do. And, you know, we do things like put price, we do price estimations. Some people know what they cost. As you know, all price estimations have a way of migrating to another development. No matter. And then this whole issue about dialogics comes into play, because people, the first thing people will say is, which do you think is the best? And if you say they're all equally good, you've disempowered the people who are there. That is to say, yeah, I know here are three possible solutions, but you know, I'm not going to tell you what I really think. So what we usually do is have an advocate for each one of these solutions. We have three or four solutions on our team as an advocate. They make an argument for them against each other. And then we invite people to come to think, what did you think? Which was more persuasive? At a certain point, they forget about the advocates and they begin focusing on the projects themselves. And at that point, we disappear. We're just coordinating a discussion. We're trying to practice kind of dialogical thing, be empathic to what they think they need, but they can't say because they're not designers and so on. So this is not, it works for us. It works because I don't know why it works. I'm not a particularly good visual designer, but you know, I'm very sensitive to bullshit in social situations, which is what people usually get when they do cooperative planning from planners. And I try to train a team that avoids its own bullshit about, or they're all equally good, that kind of stuff. But that's a different kind of planning practice. And it's not community-led in the sense that you find out what the community wants, and then you become the technical assistants to doing them. Sorry, you asked me a question that's, you know, it really gets me going on. There is a kind of romanticism about a lot of community-based development, which is false cooperation. As you're unequal, you've got the skills. They don't know what to do. And you've got to be honest to people about showing those skills, and then inviting them in into a kind of dialogical experience which leads them to clarify what they want for themselves. And it's there is a kind of narrative in that in which the experts sort of begin to disappear. And this is not original. The idea for this is not original to me. This is, does the name Saul Alinsky mean anything to, sure, to all of you? This was how Alinsky like to operate. Now, he never operated in the physical realm, but this is Alinsky-eye planning. But I am appalled when people, well-meaning young planners, come into our shop and all they want to do is bond with the community, you know, which is, it's, we've got a whole ideological set of garbage principles about what it means to actually be useful other people, which involves suppressing our own self. Sorry, really go.
Okay, we have one last question.
So I want to prod you a little bit on the macro and micro scales of your discussion. Because you've taken us from at one level, we haven't had a chance to pursue this, and I won't hear about President Obama. And on the other level, planning a community park.
Yeah.
So we have a long tradition of putting certain kinds of infrastructure at edge in edge situations, sometimes to divide people, like highways to divide black neighborhoods from white neighborhoods in cities. Other times, as you say, maybe to bring them together. But in the description, in your description of the micro plan of your group, the implicit assumption is that the small community has the power to decide. Small community, it's really, this is to serve the small community, so in the end, the park choice that they choose will be the selection of the community. But of course, in the larger issues, typically communities are on the defensive because there are much larger forces trying to bring about developments, and the small community will be lucky if it can defend the status quo rather than shape the entire plan. And I'd just be curious about your thinking in your theory of cooperation, or your theories of cooperation, whichever they are, how you relate the micro-scale kind of practice that you're deeply engaged in with your thoughts on the way in which cities and metropolitan regions can make these decisions, and the frequency with which they're prepared to make them in a way to serve the empathetic purposes that you have talked about, as opposed to respecting the divisive themes which have driven so much of our politics over so many years.
Well, it's a wonderful question. And in a way, I'm going to give you a solipsistic answer, which is this: that ideologically, I'm interested in bottom-up politics, but I'm also interested in this. I think there's more space for bottom-up politics than I sometimes imagine. And in my practice has been oriented on relatively small, discrete pieces of planning and architectural work in which communities have some control. That's the solipsistic part of this. We do best pocket parks. We never plan something that's a huge park. And that feels good to me because I'm interested in face-to-face politics. You are pointing to limits to this, which is that this is, and again goes back to this whole erratic issue. I mean, I've chosen to have a professional life where I work on things, where people in a community actually do matter, and oftentimes you can find for them spaces that they can manage, take over, occupy, and so on. Whether you could apply all of these principles that I've described as theoretical principles to a more macro level, probably not. Or you'd need a different kind of theorizing to build a notion of urban region, and so on. And that won't be something I'll do because that's not where my sensibility is. But I would say to you in this that one of the things we have done with Stephen Duncombe, is that the name you think to? He organized Billionaires for Bush. he's one of the organizers of Out of Wall Street, and we worked together. Is that we've been looking for Billionaires for Bush. great piece of political theater. He's thinking about Romney now. His creative juices are far flowing. But one of the things that he and I have been doing the last few years is looking for places that power neglected in cities. Now, that's not an answer to this. But I think it's very important that we get out of the notion that the local is simply the prisoner of larger forces. That hasn't been our experience. There are limits to finding places that power is neglected. Absolutely. But it's also it's a very energizing kind of practice and planning. But it's not systematic in the sense that what you do, what we did in the Elephant Castle, would be a model for all of London. I could never claim that. But as I said, I'm giving you a very solipsistic answer to this.